One of the things we had talked about earlier was that you were in the online music space and saw that kind of whole explosion and disruption, and, and you're now in politics. And I just wanted you to kind of assess the disruptive impact of technology in politics and where you see that headed.
Absolutely. Well, you know, I think what we started to see, you know, in 2004 was that the internet can really be this sort of lever that changes the economies of you know, doing campaigning, that change the economies of fundraising, not only in terms of making it more efficient and cheaper to fundraise, but also, you know, to make it actually, you know, not only to make it more, you know, cost effective to fundraise, but to actually be able to fundraise for more people, to give more people a voice in the process, whether it's by contributing money, whether it's by contributing time, whether it's by, you know, just feeling like they are able to speak to the campaign and be heard and have that feedback loop. And I think that's where, you know, it's when a campaign is driven entirely around television advertisements and a sort of one-way messaging to you know, to the voters and to the supporters, it's very difficult for people to really feel like they own a piece of it.
Right.
It's difficult for them to feel empowered, and so consequently, there are fewer people that want to get involved, fewer people that participate, and that means you've got to raise more money in, you know, $2,300 chunks instead of $25 chunks.
Right.
It means you've got, you know, just it's less democratic.
Mm-hmm.
So by tapping into the ability of the internet to reach out to a much broader universe of people in a much more cost-effective way, we're able to democratize the way politics gets practiced, and you know, we're able to really change the sort of you know, the economies of scale for all of the kind of standard aspects of campaigning, field organizing, door knocking, you know, doing voter registration, planning local events, getting offices opened up, getting people connected with other volunteers. All of that stuff becomes a much more efficient and easier thing to do when you're working in the online world.
So another thing that you said that really kind of captured my attention is in the way in which campaigns are almost like movies, in this way that they're these giant productions that bring together all kinds of resource and talent and even technology and infrastructure, and then they kind of dissolve.
Yeah,
and the ways in which kind of some of these technologies are now persisting, or how are those kinds of things changing with what you're doing?
Well, it's been a real challenge. I mean, in order to have these rich social engagements online, you have to write software. And, you know, as anybody that's ever built a software application knows, that's a tough thing to do in, you know, when you've got 6 months to get a complex and sophisticated platform and scalable platform up and running. The way campaigns have traditionally worked is they start out and they hire, you know, this is at a presidential level, they'll go and they'll hire software developers and they'll build their own tools. And then the campaign ends, and that all of that collected knowledge, all of the intellectual property, and all of the people who suddenly have expertise in how to build great social tools for politics, they all disperse.
Mm-hmm.
And so you end up relearning with every cycle. You end up repeating the same, you know, you build the same things over and over again. What we are trying to do as a company is to stop, is to, you know, create something that keeps the Democratic Party from having to keep building the, you know, reinventing the wheel.
Mm-hmm.
So we're a company that has a suite of software that first of all allows us to turn on sophisticated tools for smaller campaigns that in the past wouldn't have had the resources to actually go and build them themselves, and there just wasn't a good availability of tools that encouraged positive social engagement online. And secondarily, it means that from one election cycle to the next, we're able to leverage what we did the last time. And we're able to leverage both the technology, the software, but also the people who have been through an election cycle and who say, you know, we tried this 2 years ago, here's what worked, here's what didn't work, you know, why don't we try it this way this time?
Right.
That's the kind of stuff where we as a party can't afford to throw that out with every election cycle and have to relearn it. So we're trying to create a home for that technical talent and that technical know-how and the sort of strategic know-how of how do you use this stuff well. We're trying to create a home for that persists from cycle to cycle.
One of the things that I'd read about was that in the run-up to the primaries, the Clinton campaign kind of went with old-style transactional, let's go to big donors, get our big donors online, you know, not online, get them, you know, get funded through big donors, and that the Obama campaign was very astute in recognizing, A, Silicon Valley as a power base, mm-hmm. And B, the value of technology and levering things like social networks to mm-hmm. do some of the stuff. Did you see it that way, or was that just more of a simplification in the press?
I mean, I think both campaigns really did try to engage people online. I think the Obama campaign, though, was really successful in building, in giving people that sense of empowerment that leads to organic growth and rapid growth mm-hmm. of an online community. It's sort of, you can sort of say to people, well, we want you to come online and we want you to do stuff, but they've got to feel like they've got to understand where that fits into the bigger picture. Mm-hmm. And so when you have a campaign that is building itself around small dollar donations, when funded by small dollar donations and many, many individual donors, when you have a campaign that says to people, look, if you want to start I live in a neighborhood called Jamaica Plain. If you want to start the Jamaica Plain for Obama group, here's everything you need to do it.
Right.
And not only are we not going to, it's not just a passive thing. It's saying we're actively encouraging you. We want you to take the lead. We want you to be responsible for your neighbors. We want you to find other people who can help this campaign. And we want you to be creative. We want you to use your local knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
That's the kind of stuff that when the message comes through, and that's more than just providing software. I mean, that has to come through at every level of the organization, has to be giving people the message that this is how you help.
Right.
And we want you to do this. And so I think that's where the Obama campaign really excelled. It from the beginning, this was kind of in their DNA, was this isn't just Obama's campaign. This mm-hmm. is a campaign of everybody that wants to get right. involved, and here's how we're going to empower you to take that, to have that involvement.
You almost call that open source politics.
Yeah, in a way it really is. And I think, which is, of course, it's not to say that it is, there's a campaign, organization, and there's
sure.
structure and all of that, but, one of the challenges to creating successful online community is that you have to let go control a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And that doesn't mean that it becomes a free-for-all and anybody can do anything, but it means that you're not always going to be saying, okay, I want you to go to this neighborhood on this day and
right.
do this. Some of what you're trying to do is to encourage people to use their own knowledge and go, I think I should go to this neighborhood on this day because I know that they're having a big street festival and we're going to go and we're going to hand out flyers or we're going to go and
mm-hmm.
register voters. So tapping into that, letting go of some of that control. What we try to do as a company is create tools that allow our clients to give up control without creating chaos,
right.
so that people are empowered to do things on their own. But if somebody's posting inappropriate content on the blog, if people are not organizing in a way that's counterproductive to whatever the client is trying to do, there are ways to get visibility into that, and there's ways to control it. But the default state for a productive online community has got to be openness. It's
mm-hmm.
got to be this idea of, you, the members of this community, define what it is, define how it works, define what's important.
Mm-hmm.
And if you can't capture that openness, you end up with something that you might have a few users, but it never really feels like a community, and
right.
it never has that snowballing effect that you want to see.